WrestleMania 3 at the Silverdome in Pontiac, Michigan. It's a day that I'm certain my guests at this time will not forget. I'm talking about the former Intercontinental Champion of the World, Macho Man Randy
Savage. Nothing means nothing.
Nothing means nothing. Nothing means nothing. What do you mean by that?
Super Flag, bro.
Super.
More I'm talking about all the way to the top, yeah. Unjustifiably in a position that I'd rather not be in. But the cream rise to the top, oh yeah.
Division 6 Podcast. Division 6 Podcast.
And let me point to the president of the World Wrestling Federation. The Macho Man Randy Savage is not happy with your decision, yeah.
D's Delores and P's Delores.
I am the queen of the World Wrestling Federation.
Wait,
and there is no doubt about it. Yeah, you mean Gene Okerlund. You know that I'm the cream of the crop.
Wait a minute, Thor.
Welcome, everyone. You are watching and perhaps listening to Super Flag Bros on www.youtube.com/flagplus. This is the official Division E podcast of Flag Plus Football. If you were with us through the introduction, you heard us being serenaded by the sweet sounds of Macho Man Randy Savage.
It's awesome.
And if he was here, he would partake in a cage match between himself and my co-host, Deez Delores. Of course, we're at Sportira Cage, where we will be the home of underground fighting and cage matches, if that were legal. But if, for the moment, it is your leading provider of Flag Plus uniforms.
What's he talking about?
Nothing.
I lost track.
We're of course joined in the studio by our producer Mo Khan. You can tweet the show live by tweeting him at MoKhan19. You can also tweet our producer, our other producer, executive producer,
the technical director.
I forgot what your title was because it's not important.
You can follow him at
EagleFPF. He is, of course, the Eagle at Master Control. He is in charge of making sure I have my hair cut every 2 weeks.
Is it time?
Just about. It takes about 2 weeks to start the show, so when I finish my intro, I know I'm going to get a haircut. We will get into the show, but before that, I want to call D's out on his abuse of power on the FPF webpage. After the Darksiders win, he tweeted a picture of Darth Vader.
It was pretty good.
And it was reposted on the Flag Plus Football webpage. So if you haven't seen it yet, it is Darth Vader himself amidst a whole bunch of flames.
Thanks.
D's, of course, people that want to comment on that can follow you at Dave's Republic. You've seen the action this week in Divi. We're starting to see some blowouts. In the past, you've said that this is a trend that tends to continue as the better teams only improve and develop more chemistry and the weaker teams just sort of reach their max potential.
Right.
Do you think that's the case this season?
First of all, hey everybody. Glad I could speak after that long intro.
I know, I'm so tired.
Eagle, how many listeners do we have?
Right now?
Yeah.
We currently have 3 listeners.
3, it's pretty good. It's actually a downward spiral of I think we lost 6 from last week. So we're talking about blowouts in general in terms of flag football. The reason why I brought that up in previous seasons is because I feel like momentum follows between games. Like it's kind of crazy in FPF. I feel like when you start losing, like it becomes very infectious. Like momentum in the sense that a lot of us aren't really professional athletes. So when we lose, it affects us personally. It affects us mentally, and I feel like that kind of momentum it affects a lot of players in this league a lot. And then let's say you're on like an 0-5 streak, like you've seen this, Mo, as much as I have.
Yes.
Teams that lose a lot of games, like they go into the second half of the season, they have no juice.
Well, I think I digress on that point. To take the example of Jagerbombs from Division 5 last year, they started off 0-2 or 0-3, and they were literally 10 minutes away from winning the championship, which they blew the lead that they had against the U at the time here. It just depends on how you approach it, right? Where maybe you do have that mentality, as you made the point before, that, hey, let's mail in, go into August.
That's it, the guys mail in. And my guys don't even show up towards the second half of the season. That's what I'm always worried about when I see a team that's 0-4. The first thing I think of is, are they going to show up next game? Are they even going to show up?
Because honestly, it's the greatest form of disrespect to the team you're playing against when you don't show up to games. That being said, I want to address some of these blowouts this week, just because it's interesting to look at what certain teams are doing well and what other teams are struggling with. We see Smoke and Axholtz beating hashtag Baton by a score 21-0. Both teams have been subject to criticism, but we see Smoke and Axholtz finally taking a step in the right direction. Jason Kukulakis and Jordan Rossi combined for 12 catches, 71 yards. However, as they face tougher competition, will they need more from other members of this offense in order to be truly effective?
We're talking about specifically Baton.
No, about Smoke and Axels.
Smoke and Axels. I kind of feel like they're starting to hit their stride. Not that they've had new additions, but I feel like their players have kind of been fitting into the positions a lot better. Like, I don't know if Jason Kokolak has played the last couple of weeks, but I feel like, can check it up. But I feel like he has a really good chemistry with Jason Rossi. It's really good chemistry with Jason Rossi, like in a sense that they played with each other, they've played on each other's teams like in the past, like quite a lot, and he tends to be a favorite target for Jason Rossi.
Mm-hmm.
So like what I'm getting at here is
it's Jason Kokolakis, as you said, who's a player who's played with him for many seasons, and Jordan Rossi, who I would assume is related, otherwise just happens to bear a coincidental family name,
and also like Kokolakis kind of brings. He brings something special on offense.
Two games played.
That's what I thought.
Three TDs, 11 catches, and almost 100 yards receiving.
The reason why I asked that is because I didn't see him play all the games.
Mm-hmm.
So getting to my point, like he's kind of a force on defense as well, in the sense that he's very tall and
disruptive.
And disruptive. But going to hashtag Baton, like, they're kind of in a tricky spot because they haven't really scored that many points in 3 weeks.
Which we'll get to in a second. But before we talk about hashtag Baton, with your you seeing Kokolakis now on the Smoke and Axles roster, and you know Jason Rossi loves to go there, would you say that he is in fact in love with the Coco?
Oh, God.
It's a great song.
Right? Yeah. More seriously, as for hashtag Baton, Max Kevin Jocelyn having only thrown 3 touchdowns in 3 games.
Yeah.
What's wrong?
Everything's wrong. Everything's wrong. But in a sense, here's my thing. You've only scored 26 points in 4 games,
and they've never scored more than twice in a game.
At this point, just try anything. Just throw the ball deep. Like, just throw. Get. Tell all your receivers to just run downfield and just hope for the best. No, because at this point, nothing works. Like,
it's just I would say maybe try and develop an actual offensive strategy,
but that's why you're a defensive guy.
as DC Dolores would say, just everyone run in one direction and I'll try throwing the ball to you. No, but honestly, I would say the opposite. I would say try and focus, try and figure out the things that your team does well. And don't try and outthink the room. This game isn't that hard. Just try and hit the open guy.
But I get that. But they're at a point now where they're barely scoring, a touchdown a game. Like, and I think that it's at a point where it's like you're allowing 100 points in 4 games so far. And that's we're talking about offensively, but defensively they're allowing way too many yards. And that's what I'm saying. I'm not saying just throw the ball down the field every play, but just start taking risks. Like, even if you make mistakes, whatever, just keep trying. Like, keep plugging at it, you know?
That's fair.
Just the schedule ahead for hashtag Baton. They got some winnable games coming up. Royalty.
Another team that has not been scoring as well.
They got Big Blue Wrecking Crew in a few weeks' time. They play Zhongyi and Mile Public House. They can win 4 games and be maybe 4-6, even 5-5.
Yeah, and in a sense, though, this isn't like. Those are easy games to win for them, but it's also really easy games for other teams to win against them. Like, I don't think they're going to be able to win any kind of games in going down the stretch playing this style of football.
Absolutely. And another team that's been struggling has been Mile Public House. They lost to Blood Machines in a game between the most intimidating team name against the least intimidating team name, as Blood Machines win it 48-12. So before we get into actual analysis, Mo Khan, I'd like to ask you, in terms of office supplies, which do you think would be most likely to be a Blood Machine?
In what sense?
I would say the automatic pencil sharpener, because if you get your pinky stuck in there, it's guaranteed.
The stapler. Stapler is another example.
Stapler.
Hole puncher.
Your body is a Blood Machine.
Your body is also a Blood Machine. It produces blood.
Binder's pretty good.
You ever get your fingers...
We spend way too much time in an office, eh? Like, I just...
all of us. That being said... A Mile Public House, they have not yet won a game. But let's look at some of the positives. Guillaume Cavett does have 8 catches and 78 yards, 2 touchdowns. And we have 4 players on his team with a sack. Johan Fournier, Alex Ukeneg, Yannick Andre, and Yannick Jeremin. So I would like to say, like, a team like Mile Public House has been struggling. Where can you focus to build on success.
Right.
You need to build on your positives, right?
Right. In a sense, the positive thing is that they're very athletic team, get a lot of yards running the ball. And in Division E, like, okay, maybe this might be the wrong matchup for that to be your positive, running the ball, because Blood Machine's like, they'll eat that up. Like, they'll take a couple of runs here and there if they can stop you from passing. But going into further games, like, I feel like having a run heavy type of offense can maybe help them. If that's what seems to work, but maybe it's also about like slowing down the pace of the game.
Yeah,
maybe that's something else that can help them as well.
Another thing I've noticed is they still haven't solved the quarterback issue. They've had three starters in four games. We've had Yannick Andre start. We had Simon Gauthier start, and Felix Villancor all start games. I've always said the only way for anyone to get better is by playing the game. Throwing the ball well isn't enough in FPF. It's reading defenses, getting adjusted to the rusher, knowing your players, calling the right plays, and you don't get that by not playing. So you need to make a decision as to who your starting quarterback is going to be.
And Simon Gauthier has the most FPF experience. He has a 78.3 rating here. He's played for Le Monsieur Chat in years past, Golden Eagles, Spartans, and the 30 South last spring here.
That's actually a good resume. Those are all three of those teams are very strong rosters with experienced players. So if anything, I would say to take what you know about the league, take the team on your shoulders and say, all right, I might not throw the prettiest ball, I might not know what to do in the study on every given down, but given my experience, let me lead the team. This is my chance to call out Simon Gauthier, and I will do so. Simon, put the team on your back, man.
But that being said, let's just run for a sec. I get what you're saying, and the thing is, the thing to consider sometimes too is that not everybody's capable of being a quarterback in a sense that like they don't feel like no, but they're not
like
they're
this
not,
guy.
They're not capable of
or like, this guy.
Like, you know what it is, like when you need an immense amount of confidence to play that position, especially in this league. You know, that being that they have someone running in your face, it's a short game. Like, there's a lot of confidence that's involved. So if you're not confident going into the game, if you come in and tell your players like let me put you into that position, right? I come to you and I say, dude, I can't play today. I'm not feeling it. Like, what do? You tell the guy you got to play anyway.
Well, it's tough. You got to deal with the guys you have on the field that right. day. And unfortunately, that's one of the realities in FPF is you're constantly replacing players.
Like, you can't, what I'm trying to say is you can't force a guy to play, like, it's the last position you want to force a guy to play the position when he's not feeling it. You know, it's just.
That's true.
I don't know.
As for the players on Blood Machines, I saw them throwing the ball around. They were playing at the same time as our Darksiders game in Division B.
Yeah.
They were warming up. They were not warming up, but the guys on the sideline were throwing the ball around next to our bench. And I noticed an immense amount of athleticism. I'm very impressed with the athletes they have on Blood Machines.
Yeah.
So I wonder if they can translate that into future success, already having a successful season thus far.
So rather than preparing for our game, you're just checking out the dudes.
Oh, yeah, I'm not even
checking out the dudes. It's checking out that bod.
That's what I do. I check out that bod. But honestly, like, I won't pay attention when defense
is playing. Yeah, for sure. No, I got you.
As for Blood Machines, Nicolas Blay threw six touchdowns in this game. He's only played two games so far. He's 11 touchdowns, no interceptions.
Yeah.
We also have Charles Olivier Levine, who's 10 touchdowns and one interception in two games. So they kind of have like a dual quarterback system. Will this work, or should they just settle on one?
Well, I mean, I don't want to go. I don't want to be cheesy or anything, but you got to ride the hot hand, right? Like, I think I got that expression right for once. Is that I screwed it up last week? But you got to ride the right. Yeah, awesome.
Goalie expression.
Yeah, good job, producer. So, like, basically, like, what I'm saying is the guy's 11 touchdowns in two games. You can't change quarterback at this point. You just can't.
But Olivier Levine has 10 touchdowns in two games.
I get that. But at this point, at this moment,
11 is greater than 10. Mathematically, no, you're correct.
Are you going to bench a quarterback that just, like, we just spoke about confidence issues. Now, if you bench a quarterback after throwing six touchdowns, I don't care what the other guy's doing. Like, that kills every momentum that he has. So you just got to ride it, man.
That's true. Another team that can't be benched on the whole is Been There, Done That.
Yeah,
as they scored 46 points against Fuzzy Kittens, 18. As a graphic designer, I need you to break down the Been There, Done That jersey. I think it's the coolest jersey in Division E.
Okay, first of all, explain to me why you think it's the coolest jersey.
Because being colorblind, I think it's the most attractive shade of gray.
What color is it? Really? Gray. Yeah,
gray.
Aren't they purple and green? Yeah, I know, but now I feel colorblind. I gotta try to figure out what color it is.
And I love the font. It's cool.
You like the fonts?
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's lots of Helvetica.
Nope, and not even
maybe
close.
Maybe some Supreme Italic.
Nope, not even close.
All right, and Descriptive A.
Well, that sums up that subject. On to the next one.
I was actually there to see the wide receiver duo of Phil Mercier and Jean-Christophe Lavoie. Are they the best wide receiver duo?
Like in tandem. Yeah, I would say they're up there. Like, they just seem to have like consistent production, and it's kind of awesome, like, to have those kind of targets on your team. Like, and what I find impressive about this team specifically is that they're able to spread around the ball a lot, and maybe that's because they have really athletic and really, really interesting receivers to throw to. But definitely, like, it's great to have a good tandem, and in this spot, you can't just have a cool jersey. You got to have the right athletes to fill the jerseys.
That's true. And Fuzzy Kittens, I think it's just a lack of knowledge of this league. I think they'll get better week to week. We're going to cut to break momentarily.
Can I just say one thing before we cut to break?
You can say at least one thing.
I don't think it's just that. I just think that their schedule is really tough. Like, I feel bad for
them. Yeah, they have a tough start to this season.
And going forward, anyways.
Honestly, stick with it, Fuzzy Kittens. I think as the season progresses, the schedule will let up, and your experience will carry you through, and if anything, you'll be road tested if and when you get into the playoffs. And before we get to break, I just want to let the entire audience know that Ryan Aridi believes that today is the birthday of the sexiest person in the world, and that is Adriana Lima. Yeah. And so we'll think of that as we head to break. When we come back, we'll let everyone know how you run like a girl.
Calling the Audible has been brought to you by the English Montreal School Board's DEAL program. Distance education for all learners will allow you to obtain your high school diploma or prerequisites for SAGEP or vocational studies from the comfort of your own home. It's never too late to go back to school. Learn anywhere at your own pace and get your diploma. Call 514-788-5937 for information or visit www.distanced.ca for more details.
Welcome back, everyone, and thank you, Ryan Reedy, for your tweet. We know that Adriana Lima has not eaten any of the Pizza Hut hot dog stuffed crust.
Yes.
Of course, if you're watching, you know that you're watching Super Fly Bros at the Sportera Cage, where if it's in the cage, it's in the game.
Four listeners or five? I'm going to say five.
I'm going to say 17. 17 it is.
I have a question.
We have a question by our producer at MoCon. You can follow him, of course, at MoCon19.
Vincent Bastrash, if you see him next time in the field, if you remember you two.
Will not.
I hope you do.
0%.
I'll remember.
Can you ask him if he has a sister that plays basketball from McGill University?
Vincent Bastrash, MoCon is hitting on your sister.
Yep.
No. The man who should be hitting on your sister is, of course, the Eagle at Master Control. He can be tweeted and destroyed at EagleFPF.
I love how he's making us do all the dirty work.
I know, seriously. Can you ask about your sister for me?
So that he can punch you in the face first before he punches you in the face.
I just want to know. She's a really good basketball player. Okay. If they are related.
Great. That's what he cares about.
Now we know. Mokan's type is woman and basketball player.
It's pretty good.
Now we know.
And we're next to basketball player.
Seriously. She can come out to Sportera Cage and shoot some hoops with us. Deez, I want to talk to you a little bit about some of the trends we're seeing in FPF. And, of course, if you want to tweet us and talk about some of these themes, you can tweet us respectively at myself, at P's FPF, and at
Dave's Republic.
At Dave's Republic. Yeah. Also, at Hot Dog Stuff Pizza.
Yeah, man.
I want to talk a little bit about the running quarterback archetype in FPF. We've had the experience playing with both. We started in the league with a running quarterback.
Yep.
We've now...
And who tore his ACL playing for us because he ran too much.
Also, it can happen to anyone.
Meh.
We also have... we now have transitioned towards a team with a pocket quarterback.
Pocket quarterback.
So what are your general thoughts on the topic? Do you think that a running quarterback can win in FPF?
Okay, well, my point of view on running quarterbacks has been pretty simple. Like, I feel like the lower divisions is more effective. I think that having a running quarterback could be pretty effective when you're playing against inexperienced teams, because one of the most important stats in our league is conversions, being able to convert on third down. And I think that having a running quarterback sometimes gives you that, because a lot of teams, when it comes down to third down, like, not a lot of teams are experienced enough to play aggressive on third down, because they feel like they're willing to give up some space, willing to give up some yards. So I feel like having a running quarterback, and I've seen it a lot, like, where on a third down, it's like it becomes a desperation play where instead of throwing it, they'd rather just run and not have a turnover. So I think that having a running quarterback could be pretty cool. Like, if you have an effective running quarterback, I'm not talking about just some random guy in the street that doesn't have that much speed. Someone that has my speed, don't run. But if you got if you have top end speed, I think that it's essential, because it can allow you the ability to get like first downs, and it's good when you're playing against an experienced team, is what I'm saying.
Well, I want to get the opinion actually of our producer Mo Khan, who is a Hall of Famer himself and has played in high divisions, not necessarily related, but I will ask Mo. In all seriousness, Mo, you've played at the highest level in our league. We have seen some changes and some shifts in paradigm in FPF. Are we starting to see the running quarterback become more and more of a threat in the playoffs and in the playoff run?
I think yes and no. I think yes in the regular season, but come playoff time, it's so hard, because you take away the running, you take away the legs of a quarterback and force him to throw. And that means playing more of a passive-aggressive pass rush, that you don't see them be more effective in that role of being a dual-threat quarterback. However, you look at the Divi stats this year, look at the top 10 rushers, all of them are all quarterbacks, more or less, here. Mm. And you can see guys rushing for over 200 yards already after four games, which is impressive. But the question is, can you do it in the playoffs? Highly doubtful. That's why I think come playoff time, it's so much tougher, because the margin of error is so much smaller that right. If you run and you can't get that first down, that's momentum going towards the other team.
But it's also, I'd like to know, like, has there ever been a running quarterback that's won a championship?
I can think of one on top of my head, whose name is, he's quarterback for Terror Squad.
Tam
Villadeth. Tam Villadeth won the Division II championship a couple years ago.
Yeah.
Tam is also an exceptional thrower, however, so that does give him some balance. Also, having Pat Jerome, for those who are listening to the show don't know Pat Jerome, look up the stats. Seeing him play is even more impressive than that as well.
Watch that, the spring season final with that
spring
pick,
season?
The extra point.
Yes, absolutely.
Pick.
Yes, absolutely.
And a running quarterback would suggest that he runs about 30-40% of the time.
Not even that.
Not
often.
Even.
But just he has the ability to take off when necessary. I think that is a nice tool to have if you can. Another guy who had, you know, if we're looking at higher divisions, let's say, and it's as a point of reference for low division players, because they can find these games of the week, they can find these championship games, but a guy like Marco Masiotro, who has the athleticism to escape, but is primarily a pocket passer, I think that's the archetype we'll see develop. However, I want to draw some attention to some of the running quarterbacks this season. We have Etienne Gilman, Champ, as he's been nicknamed, for FOTC, John Papadimitriou of Redmen, Jason Rossi of Smoke and Axolotls, Dylan Garber of Falcons, and Rahul Mohan of Tigers. These are some of the top passers in this division, so I think we may, in fact, see a running quarterback champion in Division E this season. What do you think?
Definitely, and mostly because, like, it's not those guys, we're talking about guys that don't just have to rely on their feet. Papadimitriou, maybe, like, I think he's a really good quarterback in a sense. Like, I think he could be pretty accurate. He's pretty good players, but I've seen him playing like he's quick. He's fleet footed. I'd say like he's agile. And a lot of times it's not about the speed necessarily. Like, you know, you're hanging on by a flag, so it's really about being more agile, being able to avoid the rush. So
what about running playbooks, like teams that run sort of like either a wildcat or option?
No, I don't.
You don't think that works in
FPF? No, definitely not. Because it's not about centralizing your playbook around the run. It's In a sense, it could probably help you, like, if it's planned, but like maybe the best rushers may not be like rushing quarterbacks. It may be something that's not planned. I think
I think it hurts quarterback though as well, developing your reads.
Well, in terms of development, I couldn't agree more. Mo, I think the more that you spend time in the pocket and develop your reads, you'll become a better passer for seasons to come. But I do think that at some point we'll see quarterback, especially in the lower divisions, win on raw athleticism alone.
More likely, yeah.
Yeah. So I think and we're on the cusp of seeing it as we see these guys who can throw the ball as well. Now we know sort of the offensive strategy, but turning towards a more offensive person, I will turn to you, Deez, as it is time for your rampage of the week. What's on your mind?
There's a lot of things on my mind, my man. I'd say this week I'm going to complain a little bit about welcome taxes, because I think that
he's the reason, new homeowner, by the way.
A new homeowner, thanks. I've actually grown up for once, and I'm going to say that it's maybe the most despicable thing that can ever happen to a man. You know what a welcome tax is, Mo?
Yes, when you move to a new neighborhood, when you buy a condo or property of some sort.
And they not only does the government tax you, but they tax you a crazy amount of money, and they give you a month to pay.
30 days.
And if they don't, they cut your legs off. Maybe not figuratively, maybe not literally, but figuratively, definitely.
As you would a running quarterback.
But I'm gonna say it's like this. It's like you go to the movie theater, right? You're ready to set. You go. You got your popcorn. You got your drinks, right? And some dude comes next to you, and he eats half your popcorn, and he drinks half of your drink, and he spits on you after. I think that's what it comes down to. That's what it is.
And then he asks you for money.
And he lift home after.
So basically, what you're saying is like going to the movies with Mo Khan.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Absolutely.
It's like going
absolutely. That's definitely something to keep in mind, as well as. Some of the concepts we talked about in today's show. I just wanted to, with Thursday's lesson plan, I wanted to look at something. There's been some posts in past seasons, and one that came up this week, someone posted on the Flag Plus wall to say that a football was left behind. Gentlemen, if you find anything at the field, please make sure to do that. Please make sure to let everyone know, because nothing sucks more than getting home and realizing you're missing a shoe, some protective gear, and or a wallet or keys, although I don't know how you got home in the first place. But it definitely does suck. So if you do find something at the field, make sure to mention that. Make sure to mention to your gracious hosts at Ross or Lachine that you enjoy the company.
You know you've forgotten pants.
Oh yeah.
Shorts.
Keys, and the reason I mention phone, this is gloves, I forget everything every week.
One time he left behind his shoes, his jersey, his gloves, and his wallet. So
I want to thank Justin Okyonero for picking up all my stuff as I left. Deez, I wish you would pick up my stuff once in a while, but I will thank you for joining me on the show. Of course, you can tweet him at Deez Delarees. Also joining me in the Sportera cage, where if it's in the game, it's in the cage, is the Eagle of Master Control, who is turning my knobs and turning me on. To my left, I am joined with producer Mo Khan, who can be followed home or at MoCon19.
I just realized we're not really in a cage, though.
We're not. We're the only thing not in the cage in this building.
Yes.
We're like a demi-cage.
Yes.
Absolutely. If you'd like to join us, remember, you can join us live. And until then, enjoy your week.